We're back this morning with T General Manager Phil Ng. Thanks again for your time. There's a lot going on in the commuter rail. You were just talking to us in the break about how great the ridership numbers have been on the commuter rail. South Coast Rail, set to begin in 2025 next year. Is it on schedule and on budget?
It is absolutely on schedule. We are targeting the spring of next year, and we're super excited about that and the opportunities that brings to those communities that are looking to use mass transportation to get in and out of their communities.
Also, electric trains are being added to the Fairmont line. It's kind of a hybrid system, battery hybrid locomotives that will need time to recharge. There are some transit advocates who say they think the T should have gone the more traditional route of overhead catenary power. Why are you going this way with these battery hybrid locomotives?
Well, part of the commitment that we've made is how do we deliver meaningful results sooner? If I look to wait till I had the funding to do full catenary for those 10, 11 miles, we're not moving forward with that project right now today. But the ability to use battery electric multiple units, meaning those cars can run on battery and they can run on catenary. And the ability then to reduce the amount of catenary that needs to be installed for this program allows us to move forward with electrification, decarbonization, and improve service for the riders. And at the same time, we're going to learn from that to see how that can be done in other parts of the system. It doesn't mean there's not catenary. It just means it's not going to be for the full 10 miles. And it allows us to accelerate the future, bringing it closer today.
So there already are overhead lines on the Providence line because Amtrak uses that. Why has the T never electrified at least that line, given that the wires already exist in most places?
So right now, as we look to the next capital investment plan, those are the discussions that we're having internally on how do we best deliver and move service, improve service, and move towards the, you know, what people call a vision. I like to call something that I want to make reality. So it's those are the things that we're reviewing right now because we want to take a look at our infrastructure, our capabilities, and we want to use the limited dollars we have to be able to continue moving the needle in the right direction.
Let's talk about those dollars. Right now, the T is staring down a $700 million deficit or so. The state is tight for money, and also the incoming Trump administration has not exactly been friendly to public transportation. How can you work around that?
Well, I'll say this.
Or can you?
There has been a lot of discussion, both publicly and behind the scenes, regarding the MBTA's needs. And we're not the only agency in the country. In fact, every agency in the country is facing operating deficits. I'm optimistic that the state will be able to identify available funds to address some of those needs. We are working very aggressively with our federal partners regarding operating dollar needs. And again, it's not just our agency. And even with the Trump administration, I think they are all going to acknowledge public transportation. And transportation in general really is a quality of life issue. It connects people. And to be able to move people safely and efficiently is something that I think everybody will support. And then the other piece is the T, finding ways to deliver things better, more efficiently. The workforce that we're hiring, and I thank the Healey administration, the legislature, for the support building up our workforce, is going to allow us to be more efficient in the future because we're training them differently. We're going to look to do more work in-house as well as partner with our external partners to be able to be a better, efficient
agency. Do you think they're
going to
give you enough funding next year for what it is you want to do?
I'm optimistic that there's going to be a solve.
Would you have to hike fares, maybe?
Right now we're discussing things of how do we make it more affordable. Fares will not solve this problem. Income eligible was something we're very proud of, making that something that folks that need and want to use this system, make it available to them. Fares alone cannot solve this issue.
Our thanks once again to Phil Ng.
Thanks for being here.
The Sunday Roundtable is next. Under federal indictment, but back in the city council chambers, the message Tanya Fernandez-Anderson's putting out and what it says about calls for her to resign. Coming right back.